Hi, I'm Her Royal Highness Princess Meridian, and you are watching Diaspora Lifestyle TV.com. I am Her Royal Highness Princess Meridian Adedoyin Shilarin of the Adedoyin Anuko Royal Family Lineage and the Eledero Royal Family Lineage of Sagamu Remo Kingdom, Ogun State, in the western part of Nigeria, sub-Saharan Africa. I'm the granddaughter of His Royal Majesty Oba William Christopher Adedoyin II, the Akarigo of Remo Kingdom. My father is one of the sons of His Royal Majesty, and I happen to be my father's first child and first daughter, hence my royal title, Bere. So that's who I am. It's a privilege to be born as a royal. There's the adage that says royals have blue blood. It's just a saying, because when you cut us, it's red blood that you'll see. Everybody's blood is red. But by the special grace of God, there's a particular anointing of royalty that we have in royal blood. And you don't take it for granted. You dare not take it for granted. How I was raised by my dad and my mom, my grandmom, the queen, is royalty is actually, how am I going to put it so people can understand? It's actually a call to leadership. And leadership is service to humanity. So the fact that you're royal doesn't mean, oh, I'm going to go all over the shops buying things and wearing a tiara. You can all wear your tiara. Today I'm wearing a fascinator instead of a tiara. But we can all wear, you know, whatever it is you want to wear. As a royal, you have your crown on. You sleep with it, you walk with it, it's there. People might not see it physically unless you're dressed in your regalia, but you wear your crown. You're meant to wear it with pride, with dignity, with that ability to also influence your environment, influence your world, and bring about a better quality of life. 60. We're talking about half a century and a decade. That's a whole lot of years put together, you know. 60 is a great age. Somebody said yesterday to me that 60 is the new 40. And I guess they're probably right. 60 is a great age. It's a great age because that age of consolidation, it's no longer about you. When you turn 21, oh, the world is your oyster. You turn 30, wow, you want to do so many things, you know. You turn 40, okay, you begin to realize a lot more about life and start to put your things in perspective. When you turn 50, you're kind of, I have reached this half century age. I've done a few things. What else is there for me to do? So you have 10 years to try and tick those boxes. By the time you turn 60, as I said, it's that age of consolidation. You take a look, a holistic look at your life. You become your own biggest critic. You know, you look at your life and you do an MOT and try to see, what have I done that is worthwhile? What have I done that isn't worthwhile that I should get rid of? Because after 60, you're moving towards your septuagenarian years, 70. And therefore, it's about giving back everything you do, every day you wake up. I mean, it doesn't stop you from doing your business, making your money, caring for your family. It's really about giving back. God has preserved my life to be 60. I started celebrating my 60th from January of this year. A lot of people didn't know why, but I would put these photographs there and celebrate and put videos. And I'll share something today. My beloved mother never saw 60. She died in her sleep in her late 50s. So for me, that God preserved my life to this age, it's not because I have two heads. It's just because He's been very gracious to me. And I do not take that graciousness or that love of God, I don't take it for granted at all. And therefore, I'm very thankful. I'm very grateful. I'm very joyful that I've reached this age. I pray that I reach 70, 80, 90, maybe more, if you know, God desires. And my work from now on is about the next generation. I'm very particular about that next generation. All the mistakes we made, we want them not to make any of those mistakes. And if they do, because man is not perfect, if they do, they will have the good sense to quickly recalibrate and ensure that they go back onto the right path. I also want to laugh a lot continuously, dance a lot continuously, because life is about humor and about music. What would life be without music? Even our great God himself loves music. So I'm telling people, laugh, learn to laugh at yourself first before anybody else laughs at you. When you laugh, it gives you a big smile. You have the most amazing look on your face when you laugh. It also gives you what I call, you know, surgery that doesn't need to go under the knife. So you have a face makeup without going to do any plastic surgery. So it's plastic surgery just given to you by God. When you also dance and listen to music, it does something to your endorphins, does something to your system, to your mind. It enables you to sail through life and realize that, you know what, whatever happens, it's not the end of the world. There's still tomorrow. I can still sort out things tomorrow. But most importantly, it teaches you when you reach this age to value people. You can't value people unless you value God, value your own life, and then you value people, your nearest and your dearest. So family, your very close friends, your community, your country, your world. So those are the things that I would want to share. No time for stressing out. I don't even have time for stressing out because I live a very stressless life. I learned that my mother was as beautiful and as amazing and as a diva that she was always very stressed. Like, maybe that's part of why she passed on so early. So I learned from that. My father, on the other hand, was we call him the iconic dignified prince. That's what we call him, our iconic prince. A very dignified gentleman, very wise. He was very full of wisdom, and I tapped a lot into him. And he was my biggest mentor and my biggest fan. My father would applaud everything I did and anything I did. His little girl used to call me small girl, even right up into my 50s before he passed. And his small girl would never do anything that's wrong. Even if I was not quite right, he wouldn't say it at that moment. And then he'll find time and call me and say, small girl, let's have a word. I don't think how you did this or how you said it was quite the right way. So I also learn, and I do that with my children, and I'm also doing it with my beautiful granddaughter now, whereby you engage with people. Communication is so key. I believe God knew what he was doing when he put that love to communicate in my heart and enabled me to also pursue a life career in media, communication, and broadcasting. We can't talk about the work I do now without going back to my beginnings, which is my career in media and broadcasting. I started as a very young, naive 17-year-old in the then Nigerian Television, before we became NTA Television Authority. So it was Nigerian Television, NTV Channel 10. And it's a very interesting thing when I do share it. A friend of mine, her name is Nika, she was in the University of Ife. She was a couple of years older than me. I had just finished secondary school. And we always used to go to Nigerian Television then in Victoria Island, where we participated in a program called Youth Forum. Youth Forum was hosted by the famous Patrick Oke, who's still in media, by the way. And it was produced by the also famous Mr. Dijmon Lewis, who is more known as the Oloja of Oja. He was that king in Village Headmaster. And so we went, and this particular day, she didn't turn up. We would record on a Thursday and show the program. It would be aired on a Saturday. So she didn't turn up. Obviously, she had exams. And the producers came to me and said, Mariah, you're going to read this script. I'm like, what? No, I didn't prepare it. I didn't write it. I'm not even prepared for this. I'm just here to have fun. He said, well, it is part of the fun. Anyway, after a while, they convinced me to go into some side room to rehearse and rehearse. I'd never done that before. I'd done a lot of stuff in the school, theater and plays, but national television, this was something else. I was this 16 going on 17 year old. We eventually did it. I sat, I read. It was a poem that she'd written, and it was on courtesy, how to be courteous to people. Beautiful poem. And I hope she's probably watching this. So every time I talk about it, I give her kudos. Nike. So I ran away as soon as we finished the recording and went home. I even forgot that I had a voucher, because back in the day, they'll give you a little bit of money. So I forgot about that. And they came looking for me at home and asked me to please come to the TV house, that they wanted to see me, and gave me two letters, two envelopes. One had the voucher, which I needed to go and sign for. At that time, it was 25 naira, only about 25 quid, you know, in British pounds. For a 17-year-old, that was a lot of money. And then the other letter I opened, that had been sent from the management. They wanted me to come for an audition. What? Audition? Anyway, I went. I think I must have done about 6 or 7 auditions over a period of 5-6 months. So it's not like it is today. It was because MTV then had the BBC standard. They were in partnership with the BBC. And people don't know that Nigerian television was actually 5th in the world to ever have television. So America was first, Britain, as it was called then, Great Britain, was 2nd, Germany was 3rd, Australia was 4th, Nigeria and Africa were 5th. So that's why we used to say, WNTV, WNBS, 5th in the world, 1st in Africa. That was our slogan then. Anyway, we got into the job eventually, and that's how my career started. I became the youngest ever to be employed at age 17. Before me, there was Chijulu Koka, who then became my boss. She was the youngest at age 19. And when she started in 1958, the year I was born. So I had a very good inroad into broadcasting, very strict. I was the baby of the entire organization, as I said, and the youngest as well in my department, which is the presentation department. So we learned how to write scripts, we learned how to speak properly. We went to trainings or something called the Language Laboratory. That was a training school, and I had to go there with other my colleagues to learn. We also had exchange programs where we'd be sent to the US to do courses, sent to England, both the BBC and other training courses here. And it was wonderful. And that's how my career started. I rose up in NTA over the years. I went to study, went to higher institution, got my diploma, then came to England, did my degree in communication. But all along, I was still working. So I started working in 1975. I didn't leave Nigerian television until maybe 1997, when I finally came here to live again. I had come once in the 80s, went back, and then came back again after the military rule. It's so funny that the same President Buhari that we have now was then General Muhammadu Buhari. And I did not like the fact that military would take over countries. And I just left, because I just felt, you know, this is not the right way. So I'm happy that at least, you know, on the side sort of comment, we now have proper civilians in government in my country and other countries in Africa. We'll get there. Maybe one day we'll even have people who have never been in the military. So we'll even stop having retired military people in government, because politics is about people. It's about you and me. We are the politicians. We are the ones that vote ourselves into power. And hopefully one day again, we'll have our royals that will come back and start taking their roles in leadership. Because wherever there are royals, it's always a saner climate. Because royals, people can access the palace anytime in Africa. I'm not talking about UK, but in Africa, you can see the king anytime, because he is there for you. Politicians, on the other hand, you have to book appointments and then eventually you won't even see them. But that's, you know, a side of the point. So this, all this I'm telling you about also adds to what inspires me to do the work that I do. So everything I say is linked, interlinked. And when I came back to live in England, I decided to use my media background, my experience, the knowledge I have, to put together platforms that would also help people, showcase people, put the spotlight on people. Because at that time, I realized that mainstream didn't really have much time for us. They had their own thing that they did. Once in a while, they'll put the spotlight just to do the tick, you know, to say, okay, we did this. But there was nobody really focusing on what we did and the kind of things that resonated with us as, you know, Africans and Caribbeans. So I started my talk show on the Arise platform. And I did that with first with Passion Television, then with Ben TV. I've done a bit of work with Arise TV, which has nothing to do with my own Arise brand. They are spelled A-R-I-S-E. I'm spelled A-R-I-Z-E with an exclamation mark. I've also done things with Channel 4, BBC. I've done a few things with Al Jazeera as well. And with Heritage Television. So media is my world. My world is media. I became very involved in a lot of charity work because I just feel that with media, media is the new science. Trust me, I'm going to say it again. Media is the new science. There was a time science used to point the world where we were going, the next invention, the next industrial design, the next innovative product, the next medical discovery. But all these industries now realize that they need media to propel and to showcase what they're doing. Hence, everybody now gravitates towards media. So I thought it's a good platform to use to showcase young girls, especially who need that critical thinking and that strategic planning to ensure that their lives are better. So young girls who have been put in very precarious situations, like they are exposed to rape, child marriage, teenage pregnancies, all those things that are very bad and hideous for our young children. And therefore, I came on board of Girl Child Network Worldwide about 10 years ago, first as a trustee member. And then after a couple of years, I was elected and appointed as chair of the charity. But not just the chair of the charity, I had to become the working chair. So I'm chair of the charity, but also the official global spokesperson, which is I am the face, the voice, the ears, the hands, and the feet of those girls. They can't reach the world, but I can. And therefore, with my voice, we're able to say what they want to say, able to demand what they want to demand, and let people know exactly what their situation is. Up to date, we're very proud at Girl Child Network that we have so far across Africa, here in the UK, in the US, and in Canada, we've been able to look after over 375,000 girls. Touch wood. And I think that's a kudos to us, and we'll continue to do that work. And I also do various other things for various other numerous charities. Some I don't even talk about. I just do it in the background just to help people, mentor, train, and continue to propel and project the Pan-African vision. Yes, indeed, I am a deep, deep, passionate Pan-African. When I'm asked who I am, I usually say, first and foremost, I am a Yoruba princess of the Yoruba nation, because Yoruba existed before Africa, before Nigeria or other countries. So I'm first and foremost a Yoruba princess of the Yoruba nation, which is obviously the Oyo Empire, which stretched right across from the Kanuri Empire and it hit the Shanghai Empire across, you know, the sub-Saharan Africa. As a Yoruba princess, it is my role my duty to ensure that I'm a custodian of our traditions and our culture. The Yoruba tradition and culture goes centuries back. It predates any Western culture. That is why in 2018, the Yoruba culture is still one of the cultures that stands out anywhere you're in the world. From the language we speak, to how we look, to the way we dress, to the food we eat, to our music, to our values, to the system that we have, which is a very close-knit family system. That's, you know, that community spirit. That's what we have. And that depicts who I am as the great father of Pan-Africanism once said, the Honorable Dr. Mosiah Marcus Garvey. He said, a people without knowledge of their history or without an idea from whence they came are like a tree without roots. And I usually quickly add, they will surely die. A tree that has no roots always dies. But we can't afford to die. We will not die. We shall not die. We must not die. And that's why we say we need to arise, embrace who we are, and continue to pass on the baton to the next generation who will pass it on to the next generation. Because that's what has happened. That's why I'm also able to imbibe it. And I'm sure a lot of your viewers are also able to imbibe their culture and their tradition. I also say that identity is very key. When you don't have an identity, there's a loss of your spiritual being, a loss of self-worth, a loss of who we are. In the world today, there's this stigma, still talking about, you know, Pan-Africanism, there's a stigma about especially young people who get into trouble, into all kinds of crimes, gun crime, knife crime, name it, hooliganism, thuggery. The reason is because there's been a disconnect when there was that sad happening some 400, 500 years ago, and people of the African continent were carted away and human beings were sold as slaves to other human beings. There was a disconnect. There was a loss of identity. And as such, a lot of the young people, boys and girls, who found themselves in the diaspora, either through this heinous slave trade, or some who their parents brought them from Africa to live in the Western world, they get caught up with all they see in the Western world. And because parents are so busy trying to make ends meet, doing their businesses, going to their jobs, creating a profession for themselves, in their minds, for these same children, but they're so focused on career and business, which is worth it, is all good. But why totally focus on that and forget that I'm also bringing up young children into this very challenging world that we live in? In Africa, we say one set of parents give birth to a child, but a whole community and a whole village raises the child. Sadly, in the Western world, they've taken that away from us. They give the children a phone number to call if you tell them off or correct them and say they have rights. We all have rights as human beings. But I'm wondering, the people that came to take away human beings from Africa, did they forget about human rights at that time? They took away the rights of human beings. And now they're taking away the rights of parents to raise their children as proper human beings. So those are the kind of things that fuel me when I continue to campaign about Pan-Africanism, about being Yoruba, and what it is to be culturally Yoruba, traditionally Yoruba, and to be Yoruba that has values. So that, in a nutshell, is what fuels my passion and my love for Pan-Africanism and the Yoruba nation. From the past couple of years, I've been putting together my thoughts at where my media career is going, because once you're in media, you never retire. You do media. So that's why you see some people in their 80s, you know, 90s. You know, Mr. Larry King is still doing his thing. Miss Oprah, she's doing her thing. So we continue to do what we do. And therefore, the plan, without letting the whole cat out of the bag, is to go again with my Arise platform. And this time around, from the perspective of somebody who's reached the age of 60 and still doing what I do, showcasing people, putting the spotlight on people, young, mature, whatever shade or background they're from, but enabling them to also come and share what it is that they have, what it is that they're doing. And my job is to bring out those nuggets, unpack those things, ensure that we discuss those topics that go around our world. The most important thing is to make this world better than we met it. So I want you to watch out for Arise Conversations with Princess Muradi. That's where I'm going. To know the true character of a young boy or a male child, I always say, show me who is his grandmom, his mother, his sister, his aunt, you know, who is his wife, his girlfriend, his mistress, his side chick. All these women do exist in the life of any man, from when he was a child till he becomes an adult. So whatever you put into the lives of that young boy or the man is so important. Please ensure that you put your right foot best and you gave it your best, because you are being represented by that boy or that man. That is my advice to every woman out there. That's what I've done. I continue to work on that, and I pray that you'll do the same and just make this world a better place for each and every one. God bless you.